am Dr. Joe Galati, and thanks very much for looking at this video on what I have titled this, The Liver Specialists of Texas Buzzwords. Now, what on earth are these buzzwords? These buzzwords represent terms, phrases, conditions, diseases that are of the utmost importance to us, the providers, and our staff at Liver Specialists of Texas. These are problems or conditions or situations that will immediately raise, in a sense, a red flag that immediate attention is needed for the care of our patient. Now, for patients that are looking at this or other people that want to learn about liver disease, caretakers, and family members, we want you to be comfortable with understanding the terms and phrases, or as I like to call, the buzzwords that are of most importance to us. And so for everybody, both our staff, other healthcare providers, patients, caretakers, if you have a really good understanding of what these buzzwords are, catchphrases, whatever you'd like to call them, that is a pretty good signal that we're able to communicate on the same level in a sense. And so whether or not it is a weekend, it's the middle of the day, it's a holiday, whatever the situation is, these buzzwords and phrases and conditions, if you find yourself confronted with one of these situations and you have a question, it really is imperative that you give us a call immediately at the office to run it by us. And if we get a phone call from a patient or a family member or caretaker that mentions one of these buzzwords or one of these more serious conditions, that is going to cause a immediate reaction by our staff to contact me or one of our other providers in the office, one of the nurse practitioners, to seek immediate attention, answer your questions, and sort the problem out. So, without further ado, here is the Liver Specialists of Texas buzzwords that you need to know. All right, so the first buzzword that probably takes top priority over everything is bleeding. If a patient mentions or a family member calls us and tells us that they are bleeding, that is an immediate problem. We will typically put the call on hold, seek out immediately one of our providers, either myself or one of the nurse practitioners, and see to it that we address the problem immediately. In patients with liver disease, bleeding is a tremendous problem, and it can be life-threatening, and it certainly is a serious medical or surgical emergency. In patients that have liver disease, especially those that have cirrhosis, they develop a condition called portal hypertension. This occurs when blood cannot properly flow through the liver. Pressure in these blood vessels builds up, and the person will develop something called varices, either in your esophagus or in your stomach, and they are called either esophageal varices or gastric varices. And the problem is that these varices over time may rupture and hemorrhage, and you'll experience really a torrential hemorrhage. Now, you may throw up blood, as unpleasant as that sounds. It'll be bright red blood. That is a very serious problem. It may be coffee ground bleeding or coffee ground vomiting, and literally it looks like old black, dark brown coffee grounds. That occurs because when blood sits in the stomach, the acid of the stomach causes a chemical reaction and the blood turns black. Now, another sign that you may be bleeding is if you have black stools. That's called melena. That would be a sign typically that you're having an upper GI bleed, usually the esophagus, stomach, or the first part of the small bowel. In some cases, the blood that you may see in your stool is maroon colored. That's called hematochezia. And that usually may represent, not every case is textbook, that you are having a very brisk, a very rapid bleed so that the blood does not have time to sit in the stomach and get acted on by the acid, turning it black. And it's really a mix between black and bright red blood, which is sort of that maroon. So if you throw up bright red blood, you throw up what looks like old coffee grounds, or your stool or bowel movement is bright red, or that maroon color, sort of a Texas A&M maroon, that is an immediate problem that would require day or night, regardless of the situation, you need to either call 911, tell them it's a medical emergency, or call our office and then we will immediately triage you either to go to a local emergency room, come to an emergency room in Houston in the Texas Medical Center, or possibly, though I definitely wouldn't advise this, if you need to come to the office, but we'll certainly sort that out on the telephone. But bleeding, number one buzzword. Another buzzword that we may hear on the telephone is when somebody may call up and say, there's confusion. The patient is confused. I am feeling confused. Or any sort of altered mental status. Confusion in a liver patient may represent the presence of or worsening of hepatic encephalopathy. This is a confusion state. It's a neuropsychiatric condition that develops when the liver is not able to filter out the toxins that the body normally makes. And so confusion may manifest itself by the person is sleeping more, they are forgetful, their memory is just not quite what it should be, they are not walking, their gait is off a little bit. There may be a reversal of sleeping. People will sleep during the day and they are completely awake at night. That day-night reversal may be a sign of encephalopathy and confusion. Again, we would want to receive a phone call if the patient is experiencing any kind of confusion that isn't within the norm of what they have. Again, calling us early and us receiving the phone call, allowing early intervention, can save a significant hospitalization or other complications that can develop with confusion. Now, confusion that is allowed to go on for a longer period of time may actually progress to coma, where the person is completely unconscious. And again, that is a serious medical emergency that would require hospitalization, many times in the intensive care unit. And so understanding that confusion, it's one of those buzzwords, call us immediately, we will take action and try to take care of you. Now, along the same lines as confusion, I just want to reiterate the hepatic encephalopathy, this confusion state that develops. This is very common, especially in people that have cirrhosis and hepatic encephalopathy, that confusion, neuropsychiatric condition. It's typically treated with a medication called lactulose, which is a very sweet, syrupy liquid medicine that you would take. Any change in the hepatic encephalopathy, where the person is generally functioning okay, generally going about their normal routine at home. If there's any deviation from that, you would want to call us. Again, it's one of those buzzwords, worsening hepatic encephalopathy or confusion. They're sort of intermixed. And what I train the staff is to be on the lookout for the word confusion or worsening encephalopathy or hepatic encephalopathy, as we call it. It's really important that we react and that you understand the significance of that particular buzzword. One of the more common buzzwords is fever. Now, typically, patients with liver disease are more prone to infections and it may manifest itself with a fever. Now, typically, we have over the years stated that a fever of 101.5 is sort of that cutoff for when you should give us a call. But you know what? 101.5, 101.3, to me, there isn't much of a difference between those two numbers. So I would say any persistent fever for more than a half day, along with the person not feeling well, should certainly trigger a phone call to the office or to your primary care physician. But again, when patients call or family members call and they mention fever in somebody with liver disease, that usually is one of those buzzwords that's going to get us attention. You know, another buzzword that we're all very sensitive to is pain. Now, pain in a liver patient or somebody with liver disease comes in a lot of different flavors and varieties. Now, the context of the pain, if you were doing work around the house and you twisted your ankle or you injured your finger and you have pain in your finger, that may not be a primary call to us. You may want to call your primary care physician on that. But we are talking abdominal pain in particular. And abdominal pain may represent so many different things. We talked about bleeding. Bleeding may initially present itself with abdominal pain before you see overt signs of bleeding. Pain in the abdomen may represent an infection, and we'll talk about that in a few minutes. But I would say pain needs to be called upon. And again, our staff will react to patients that call with abdominal pain. It may represent some more serious problem going on within the abdomen or liver or the digestive tract. It may represent bleeding. It may represent an infection or some other circulatory problem. But pain is certainly going to be one of those buzzwords that's going to get our attention. And again, don't hesitate to call if you are developing new abdominal pain or worsening abdominal pain that you're not familiar with. Now, one of the terms that we have is progressive weakness. Now, this is again in the eye of the beholder to say, I am getting more progressively weak over time. And that is very difficult to interpret. But certainly, if you are in a position where a week ago or 2 weeks ago, you were able to go to work, you were able to drive, you were able to take care of your usual activities around house or other responsibilities you have, and you found that over the last few days or a couple of weeks, you were getting more progressively weak, that really should trigger a phone call. And when you call us and you describe this worsening weakness or progressive weakness, that really is going to get our attention. It may be an electrolyte problem. You may be dehydrated. It could be related to anemia, which is related to bleeding, or some other infection. So again, it's hard to really make the diagnosis over the phone when somebody says they are progressively weak, but the key message here is you have to let us know so that we can act upon it and direct you where to go. Again, this is something where you'd either go to the emergency room, come into our office, or we would refer you to back to your family doctor or somebody locally close to home. Now, a term that we always worry about is shortness of breath. When you call us and describe that you are, or again, your family member is more short of breath, that really has to be a condition that's looked at carefully. Shortness of breath may represent a primary heart problem. It may represent a lung problem. Now, from a liver situation, how does shortness of breath react to the liver? What does the liver have to do with shortness of breath? Well, many times our patients will develop fluid collections in their lungs, and that's called a pleural effusion. It typically is on the right-hand side of the chest, the right lung, and that may be progressive accumulation of fluid from the abdomen that travels up into the lung. You develop this pleural effusion on the right side, and as you can imagine, if your lung is being filled with fluid, you're going to have tremendous difficulty breathing. You may find that at rest, when you're just sitting at the kitchen table, you're sitting at a computer, you're sitting at a car, you're not too short of breath. But once you start to exert yourself, walk on a flat area, or try to walk upstairs, or even exert yourself a little bit, you may find that your shortness of breath is exacerbated a little bit more. That requires a phone call. If indeed you call us and we get that phone call, we are going to make it a priority. It's one of those buzzwords, shortness of breath. You know, it's hard for me as we go through these buzzwords to say one term is more important than the other, but one that always, no matter where you go, whether it's in a liver disease practice, digestive, cardiology, pulmonary, an orthopedist, if you are having chest pain, that is something that we've trained our staff. Chest pain triggers an immediate reaction to get one of the providers or myself on the phone involved in the case. Again, chest pain typically may represent something related to the heart. It could be a heart attack. It could be a stroke, a bunch of different things. And again, to go into detail here really would take another hour. But be it suffice to say, chest pain requires a phone call, if it's severe, 911, or give us a call and then we will triage where you need to go. But again, anybody calling our office with chest pain is going to get immediate attention. It really is one of those things that you may not have the time to take a message and have somebody call you back in the afternoon. It really has to be addressed right away. Chest pain, one of those buzzwords. Along the lines of chest pain is headache. Now, again, there are a million different causes of headache. But in our patients, if this is a new onset headache and it's not related to having a head cold or a little bit of a sinus problem, but if this is one of the worst headaches you have ever had, or you are not a headache person, you don't have migraines, you don't have tension headaches, and this is something new for you, you need to alert somebody about a headache. And again, any of our patients that are going to call in with a headache, that's going to get immediate attention, whether or not it is an infection, it's an eye problem, it's an ear problem, head and neck type problem, have you had a stroke, are you bleeding into your head, did you fall? Again, lots of different things that we have to think about, but the most important thing is call, get in touch with somebody, and we are going to help triage you to the right place. But again, if you are unsure and realizing that, hey, this is like the worst headache that my mother or father or my brother, my wife, my husband is having, do not hesitate to call 911 and seek out emergency care right away as well. Now, one of the terms here, as far as a buzzword goes, really relates more to new patients that are calling our office. If anybody calls up and tells us that they need to come to Liver Specialists of Texas, they need to see a liver specialist, and last week, 2 weeks ago, I was diagnosed with a liver tumor or liver cancer, there again, that person is going to be fast-tracked to be seen literally the next day, because with liver disease and cirrhosis, liver cancer, also called hepatocellular carcinoma, unfortunately is a very common complication that we see in our patients. And like any cancer or malignancy, time is of the essence. We want to get these patients seen right away. With patients with liver cancer, it may be that you will be a candidate for a liver transplant. We have other videos talking about liver cancer, hepatocellular carcinoma, and the role of liver transplant and the different therapies that we have, something about the MELD score and the MELD exception points to allow you to get a transplant a little bit faster. But again, what I would say, if somebody was to call into our office and our staff hears liver cancer, liver tumor, we're going to fast track that patient and get an appointment as soon as possible. Now, a common term in the world of liver disease is jaundice or yellowing of the skin. That typically signifies more serious liver damage or more complications related to liver disease. And so if you are the patient or you are the family member caretaker, and you notice that the eyes, the whites of their eyes is turning yellow, their skin is turning a little darker, their urine is turning dark, they may be experiencing jaundice, which may be a serious problem. In a similar fashion, if we get a phone call, one of those buzzwords is jaundice or yellowing of the skin, it usually signifies a more serious complication, and we're going to want to evaluate that patient sooner than later, a little bit more quicker, and get them in. Certainly, the jaundice or the yellowing of the skin is an indicator of some other problem within the liver. It may represent a tumor, it may represent some sort of obstruction, some blockage of the bile duct, or it may simply represent a more extensive amount of inflammation or hepatitis that is going on. But again, one of those buzzwords, jaundice, yellowing of the skin. If you call us or my staff receives a call from somebody with that, we're going to fast track them in and take care of it right away. It's one of those things that we just are not going to sit on. Two terms that I will sort of lump into one. One is ascites, and one is swelling of the abdomen. So ascites is the collection of fluid or liquid in the abdomen in patients with very advanced liver disease. The symptom that they may have is some distension, abdominal pain, maybe fever, but the outward sign that they're going to see is distension and swelling. And so family members may call us up, the patient may call up, or a physician, a referring physician may call us up and say, Mr. Jones has swelling in their abdomen. Oh, by the way, they also have liver disease. And so that is going to be, in a sense, a red flag to our staff, one of the buzzwords, that we need to see them sooner, or it should trigger a phone call. Now, there are patients of ours that we've been seeing for months or years with chronic liver disease, maybe the early stages of cirrhosis, and now out of the blue, over a day or two, they develop swelling of the abdomen, and maybe we're seeing that patient every 6 months or so. That would trigger an appointment, of course, as I've been saying so many times here, sooner than later. The next day, within 2 days, that same week, we're going to see them to get them evaluated right away. So the buzzword would be, hey, I was diagnosed with ascites or new onset ascites, red flag. Number two, swelling in the abdomen, another red flag or buzzword that we have to react to right away. Now, I was talking about bleeding at the beginning of this conversation, and many times the patient may not have experienced obvious bleeding or hemorrhage. They may not have required any blood transfusion, but they had an endoscopy, which is a scope test with a flexible instrument looking inside the esophagus and stomach. And at the end of the procedure, the doctor said, gee, you have esophageal or gastric varices, V-A-R-I-C-E-S. And so there may be some question as to what to do with that. Now, the development of esophageal or gastric varices, those are the varices in the stomach, do signify more advanced liver disease, and you should be seen by a liver specialist or even be seen by us in the context of being evaluated for a liver transplant. Once you develop esophageal varices, even if they're not bleeding, is an indicator that more serious problems to the liver have developed. And that will trigger a whole separate series of surveillance procedures and imaging that we have to be aware of. So again, even though you may not have had a serious life-threatening complication, there's been no hemorrhage, but you're given a report that says, I have esophageal varices on the endoscopy, that would certainly warrant our attention to get you in sooner to evaluate it further. The key thing with esophageal varices, if you have not bled before, is to prevent that first bleed. That's very important, to prevent the bleeding. Now, one term that a patient or family member or other practice may call us about is if somebody has peritonitis. Now, peritonitis is an infection of the fluid of the abdomen. I already talked a little bit about ascites. That is the fluid that develops in the abdomen when you have cirrhosis and a condition called portal hypertension. That fluid in the abdomen, the ascites, does have the potential to become infected. When it becomes infected, it typically is a bacterial infection that is called peritonitis. Now, the patient may manifest by having fever, abdominal pain. They may develop hepatic encephalopathy or confusion. You can see these are all the buzzwords that are sort of intertwining and building on each other. And certainly it can precipitate hepatic encephalopathy and the development of hepatic coma. A person may go into coma, be completely unconscious. Again, a serious medical emergency. Now, the one thing about developing peritonitis, it typically will be treated and respond to antibiotics, either intravenous antibiotics or oral antibiotics by mouth. But once a patient with liver disease and cirrhosis develops peritonitis, that tells us that their clinical course in the next year is going to be more serious. There's a greater chance of more complications. There's a greater chance of that person not surviving. So again, when we receive a phone call from patient, family, caretaker, other office, that a patient has developed peritonitis, again, red flag, bells and whistles go off in the office. We want to see that patient sooner and identify just what the extent of their liver disease is. Are we talking about a liver transplant now, something in the weeks or months to come, or something within the next year? But again, that decision making has to typically come through us, and we will work in concert with the other physicians that the patient has. But peritonitis, again, significant problem that needs to be brought to us, and we will react accordingly due to the decreased survival that patients have with this condition. Speaking of liver transplant, many times patients will be told, it'll be mentioned to them, that maybe you need a liver transplant, maybe you should go visit with a liver transplant team, maybe you should get on the list now, so that later when you get sick, you're already in place. Well, that sort of thinking is okay, but I think everybody needs to learn just a little bit more about it. There are some situations where a liver transplant evaluation is warranted. Somebody that has a liver cancer, you want to get evaluated for liver transplant. Somebody that has ascites, that swelling in the abdomen, should consider a liver transplant evaluation. Peritonitis, infection in the abdomen, they need to be evaluated for transplant. Hepatic encephalopathy need to be evaluated for transplant. Signs of severe malnutrition, you're losing weight, you're losing muscle. Somebody that typically had decent-sized arms, forearms, biceps, triceps, and now they are just melting away, that is a sign of advanced liver disease, and certainly these people need to be evaluated for transplant. So if you are the patient, and nobody, no other physician is doing this on purpose, but if they casually say, hey, you should think about being evaluated for liver transplant, to me, that is code to call us up and come on down to be evaluated right away for a liver transplant. Now, for my staff receiving those phone calls when in talking to the family or talking to the patient and they mention, you know, my family doctor or my other specialist thought maybe at some time I should be evaluated for transplant. That sort of terminology or that sort of discussion will trigger us to get you in again sooner than later. That's one of those buzzwords that our staff is always listening for when they're talking to you on the phone. Have you been told you need a liver transplant? Again, leave the heavy lifting, the heavy thinking to us. We will come and evaluate you looking at your old labs and your scans and your clinical course, admissions, and just your clinical history. Leave it to us, but you do want to take it seriously and get evaluated for transplant. You know, another buzzword that I am in particular sensitive to is if a patient calls to say they were recently hospitalized for a complication related to their liver disease. That's something that I want to know about. The staff will contact me right away. So even though the comment that Mr. Smith, Mrs. Johnson may have been admitted to the hospital and maybe they are just checking in with us to alert us to that, I'm going to take that a little bit more seriously to say that if they have liver disease and cirrhosis and conditions that we are treating, and they end up in a hospital closer to home, or they were on vacation, or they were traveling, I would want to see that person in follow-up sooner than later. So one of those buzzwords, again, recent hospitalization, my staff is going to react, and we want to get you in the mood of keeping us, if you're an existing patient of us, keeping us in the loop to tell us when you are admitted to the hospital and follow up from there. It's very, very important. You know, there are so many different terms that are on this sheet, and this is the buzzword list that all of our staff have taped or stapled next to their phone and that they are scanning every single day. Two words here. One is portal hypertension, and that is the condition that develops in the setting of cirrhosis and more advanced liver disease when blood has difficulty flowing through the liver. The resistance of blood builds up, and that is what triggers the development of these varices I was talking about, which then triggers bleeding. The portal hypertension will precipitate the hepatic encephalopathy, that confusion state that I was talking about, and the bleeding. It's all related to portal hypertension. So when we hear or talk to patients about portal hypertension, that typically is a sign that they have more advanced complications of cirrhosis. The other word is anemia. Now, anemia is just simply a drop in your hemoglobin. Your hemoglobin count is low. And again, if you were to talk to a hematologist, which is a blood specialist, they have 50 different causes of anemia. In our setting, that of liver disease and chronic liver disease and hepatitis and fatty liver, things like that, anemia in our world indicates bleeding. And I've mentioned the word bleeding probably 25 times so far, maybe not, because bleeding is such an important complication of liver disease. It's one of those buzzwords, bleeding. As a result of bleeding, you become anemic. And so here again, the play on words is that when you call us, you may call or my staff may receive a message that, hey, I was told I am anemic. Well, again, you have to think as a hematologist, there's 50 causes of anemia. Liver specialist, we're thinking one cause only, bleeding. And we're going to ask more questions, but probably have that person in. If the anemia is new, we'd want to make sure that you are not bleeding. Now, a very common procedure that we perform on our patients, and we get many phone calls and referrals and a lot of questions about this, is something called a TIPS procedure. Now, TIPS stands for transjugular intrahepatic portosystemic shunt. Now, that is a total mouthful, but the TIPS procedure is a procedure that our interventional radiologists do. These are radiologists that do all sorts of procedures inside the blood vessels. And the TIPS procedure, in a sense, controls the portal hypertension that develops because of cirrhosis. And so just to review real quickly, portal hypertension is that condition that develops in the setting of cirrhosis. Blood cannot flow through the liver. The blood pressure and resistance of blood flow through the liver builds up. You develop all of these complications, esophageal and gastric varices, and you bleed, ascites, the hepatic encephalopathy, infections, confusion, all related to portal hypertension, all due to abnormal blood flow through the liver. I tell my patients that one of the complications of liver disease and portal hypertension, it ultimately turns out to be a plumbing problem. Blood cannot get through the liver. And so what the radiologists are able to do by inserting this shunt inside the liver, it's a metallic stent. It comes in different sizes, widths, lengths, that they are basically creating a new blood vessel inside the liver to allow better drainage of blood through the liver. And that buildup of pressure, the portal hypertension, goes down to normal levels. And in many cases, all of the other complications that you may be dealing with the bleeding, the ascites, the fluid in the chest, which I didn't mention, also develops as a result of portal hypertension. That, in better than 75% of the cases, goes away and is resolved. There are other complications later on that develop with the tips, but if we receive a phone call or a staff receives a phone call and the person on the other end of the phone says, yes, I was referred for a tips, or my doctor thinks I need a tips, or I need to talk to somebody about a tips. Again, red flag, buzzword, this person typically is having more severe complications and we want to get in to see that person much sooner than later. So tips, transjugular intrahepatic portosystemic shunt, big word, but that's what it stands for. And so all of these buzzwords, I hope that this has been enlightening for you to understand. And again, the premise of all this is for our staff at Liver Specialists of Texas to understand that when they receive an inbound phone call and a patient or family member or other physician's office mentions that my patient has a liver tumor or they have esophageal varices, these are signals, in a sense, we're calling them buzzwords here, signals that this phone call, this message, this patient problem goes to a higher priority, and we will get one of the providers or myself involved in the case immediately to provide the best care. Because in liver disease, the challenge of liver disease, which we all love, is that many times our patients are very sick, and we do not have the luxury of waiting to the end of the day. We have to act upon things right away. So these buzzwords for our staff in the ongoing teaching and education and enlightening of our staff that we're very proud of, as well as our patients. We want our patients to be partners in education, partners in care, so that we can provide the best care to you. Thanks very much for watching this video. Of course, continue to follow us on our website, texasliver.com. That is a portal to communicate with us, our YouTube page, our blog, Facebook, lots of information there for our patients and everybody that's interested in liver disease. Have a great day, continued good health, and we'll see you soon.